Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, good morning and welcome to all of you. We're very glad that you could join us for this truly remarkable event. I don't think that any university in America has ever brought together in a one-day program so many of the nation's most distinguished historians of the early period of our own history as a nation. And so this indeed is an important event. It's a unique opportunity to learn about our roots and the roots of the greatness of our nation. The teach-in on America's founding is one of the most important single-day programs on American history ever held in our state, and we're very proud to be able to host it here at the University of Oklahoma. I also want to welcome the hundreds who are across the street watching us on simulcast, because we were not able to get all of our guests into this single building this morning. It is said that to remain great, Americans must understand how we became great in the first place. And as we live through an age in which recent polling data indicates that over 70% of our people are pessimistic about our future, that they don't think our future will be as great as our past, it's especially important for us to come together, to have this conversation together, to understand those people and those ideas and the kind of society that was formed that helped build the greatness of our country. We believe at the University of Oklahoma that one of our most important responsibilities and one of the most important responsibilities of any university is to prepare our students for citizenship, knowledgeable, informed, and active citizenship to keep our country on the right path. And to promote a better understanding of this important component of America's past and future, the university has created a home for the study of this seminal document, the Institute for America's Constitutional Heritage, designed to encourage students to pursue the study of the Constitution. We're now working between this institute and our law school to establish a PhD program with emphasis on American constitutional studies that will allow students to get law degrees and a PhD at the same time in constitutional studies. This will be one of the first in the country when it is firmly established. And in conjunction with many dedicated faculty members who've come together to make this program possible, the Institute is led by Professor Kyle Harper, who is one of our own undergraduates, who drifted off to Harvard for 5 or 6 years, where he obtained his doctorate in classical history, and he's provided wonderful leadership for our institute. We've gathered here today some of the most remarkable historians in our country, as I said a moment ago, and they include 3 winners of the Pulitzer Prize: David McCullough, Gordon S. Wood, and David Hackett Fisher. You will be hearing from all of them in the course of the day. And other absolutely distinguished scholars who have been awarded many honors also among them: Rosemarie Zaghari, professor of history at George Mason University, who will be bringing us the very interesting discussion on founding mothers, the role of women in our early constitutional period. Akhil Reed Amar, professor of law and political science at Yale University, who is regarded by many as the preeminent scholar on the American constitutional history in the entire country. We will also have with us Diane Rehm from National Public Radio, who will moderate a panel with all of our speakers later on this afternoon. And the speaker for our first session that I'm privileged to introduce, and I have to tell all of you that I felt like I was in a candy store last night, because we had this group together for informal discussion at our house. We more or less sat in a circle after dinner, and to hear them quiz each other, comment to some degree on each other's work, very politely, it was the most stimulating evening that I've had in a long time, and I know from that experience what a stimulating day all of you are going to have. I hope that you'll be able to attend virtually all of the sessions because each will bring a different perspective on the individuals who played such an important role and on the ideas, and as I said, on the kind of societal values that also indirectly produced the kind of developments that occurred and produced our Constitution. Our first speaker in this session is Peter Onoff, a specialist in history of the early American Republic. Professor Onoff's recent work on Thomas Jefferson, on his political thought, culminated in the publication of his book, Jefferson's Empire, The Language of American Nationhood and the Mind of Thomas Jefferson. And it grew out of earlier studies on his part on the history of American federalism, foreign policy, and political economy. He holds the Jefferson Chair at the University of Virginia, where he teaches. He is also the co-host of a radio program entitled Backstory with American History Guys, which was awarded the Federation of State Humanities Council's Helen and Martin Schwartz Prize, presented annually to the nation's best humanities project. He is a distinguished scholar, an active teacher, a person who also is making an effort to educate the American public about the importance of Thomas Jefferson and his role in the founding. His speech, his lecture is entitled Thomas Jefferson's Founding. So it's a great pleasure for me to present to you Professor Peter Onoff.
Is that for me or Jefferson? I confuse the two sometimes. I want to begin by talking about the world of the founders, and I am controversially going to include Jefferson as one of the founders. You students of American history know he wasn't there, and therefore he was not the father or in any way related to the document that was produced at Philadelphia. But he and James Madison, of course, were lifetime friends. Madison is the so-called father of the Constitution. And what I want to talk about a little bit today is the quarrel between these great friends who supported each other in a common project to secure the success of this great experiment in Republican government, and what we can learn from their quarrels and their differences. And to get a better sense of this, I want to start by suggesting that the anxieties that President Boren articulated about today's sense of polarization, of driftlessness, of the imminent collapse of the Republic as the world gets warmer and warmer, I know that's a controversial position in Oklahoma, and he didn't say anything about this. I think the best way to get into the founding is to understand that these were anxious people too in anxious times. If you think things are bad now, put yourself into their world. Imagine what it would have been like in a weak union of Republican states on the brink of falling apart, when the very idea that the people were capable of governing themselves was extremely controversial. In fact, the idea of democracy itself had pejorative, negative connotations. What is democracy? Democracy is the rule of the mob, of the people, and the people are a beast. What would they do if they got power? Well, they'd redistribute property. Have you heard that before? The first charges of socialism in American history go back to the founding period when anxious elites, rich people, worried that the common folk would gain control of the government and pass what they called agrarian policies, that is, to redistribute as in ancient Rome. Agrarianism used to be a dirty word. So how did this people, and remember the American Revolution was not a popular movement in its origins. It was a movement of provincial elites, of people like Thomas Jefferson, to protect their position in the British Empire. It was a movement to reform the British Empire. Americans didn't want to be Americans. Sometimes these days, some of us don't want to be Americans. They wanted to be British. They wanted to enjoy the rights of Englishmen. But their world was on the verge of falling apart. They won the American Revolution, but that notion of 70% that President Boren mentioned, well, John Adams thought that perhaps as many as 67% of the American people weren't fully on board with the American Revolution. We historians think he's exaggerating a little bit, but you get the point. There were many loyalists. Happily, most of them left. No, I'm joking. Most of them were accepted and incorporated in American society. There were many people who Thomas Paine would have called fair-weather friends. Which army is where? The great problem was, how could this republic of republics, this loose federation, survive? Now, nobody was more conscious of the problems of union and the problems of the future of the United States than Thomas Jefferson, precisely because he was not in the United States, but aware of its weakness, of its impotence, of the absolute compelling necessity to do something. But did they do the right thing in Philadelphia? That is a short version of the question Americans have been asking themselves ever since. I want to tell you, as a student of the early republic, that there is no universal agreement among the founders, some of whom didn't sign, among Americans, in the ratifying conventions. It was a very near thing. The language of miracle, that there was some divine intervention, is actually an expression of how close the whole thing came to falling apart. Given the kind of people we are, you might say, how could the Union possibly have survived? How could we have a Union that would include the great slaveholders of South Carolina and the Chesapeake? And my ancestors, not on my Polish side, my other ancestors, those flinty New Englanders and their intolerance of the great nabobs of the South. That's just a caricature of some of the differences. But these colonies that became states had no common bond aside from their connection with Britain. They were much closer because of the nature of their economies and societies to British society than to any emerging American society. The very idea of America is an invention. And this is the sense of the significance of the founding enterprise. We better get it right now, because this is the only way we can guarantee that we will be remembered. The idea of the founders, it's their idea. They saw themselves as lawgivers. At this unique moment in world history, the first time you could ever do this, determine your own destiny. Well, the idea that they got it right, of course, is central to our civic religion in America. We worship the founders. Thomas Jefferson said, "Don't." And that's the point I want to make today. There is nobody in the founding period who is more conscious of both the danger of the Union, the risks, but also he's more intensely conscious of the rights of an individual. There is a strong libertarian tendency in Jefferson's thought, in his obsession with rights. On the other hand, there's a strong tendency toward realism, to be aware of the great dangers confronting the nation and the need to mobilize the force of the nation to sustain its enterprise. So what was his problem with the Constitution? Why did he say to his good friend Madison, "I don't think we should revere this document. It has many imperfections, and nothing personal, Jemmy, but I don't see you as a father or as a founder." Now, I'm paraphrasing. It's only because I know him so well I can say this. As I frequently point out, Jefferson never would have gotten tenure at the University of Virginia. His publication list is extremely limited, and he was a lousy public speaker. So why wouldn't he say, good work, Mr. Madison, and we should all rally around this document? Why at just the moment when Madison wanted him to say, well done, I understand you had to make compromises that you're not happy with, but you did the right thing. Why did Jefferson say, everybody on earth has a right to a Bill of Rights, and there's not one in the Constitution? That's a major defect. And what about this idea that the president can be re-elected? You know, there's only one plausible candidate for president, and everybody knew who that was going to be. And I'm not going to mention his name. Later today, you'll see Gordon Wood's necktie, and it has this man's signature all over it. One person had face recognition, images circulated of this one person. But was that the future? Well, what if this president is perpetually reelected and that becomes the constitutional precedent? Well, then we are squinting, more than squinting, to borrow Patrick Henry's phrase, at monarchy. Didn't we fight a revolution on the premises of the Declaration of Independence, that all men are created equal and government is based on the consent of the people? Is that a one-off? Did that just happen in 1787 or in the ratification meetings that took place thereafter when the people said, yes, that's it, folks. Shut up. You have a constitution. What is consent? That's Jefferson's question. And that raises the question of democracy. And this is the main point I want to make in the few minutes that I have this morning, is to suggest, in case it's news to you, but I want to suggest that there's a fundamental tension between the tradition of rule of law and constitutionalism and what we call democracy. Jefferson became a Democrat because he recognized that tension. And that is, Jefferson made war throughout his entire career against the principles of monarchy and aristocracy, that a few privileged families or one single family should rule time out of mind simply because of their genealogical connections. Republicanism is based on the principle that, as he put it in a famous letter to James Madison, the earth belongs to the living. Every generation, and that would include us now, we are the source of our own authority. Here's Jefferson's radical answer to the question of who are the founders. Madison and his colleagues wanted to be remembered as founders. They wanted to have fame, a great obsession of the 18th century, a sort of secular substitute for going to heaven, is to be remembered in future generations. This was a heady moment for these people, but Jefferson said, wait, there's a problem here. If this experiment is going to succeed, it's because we are our own founders. We have created this republic and we will sustain it. They were anxious then, we are anxious now. That anxiety is the predicate of Republican government. It's not going to be easy, folks. Now, I don't want to get into a secular sermon about these times we live in, but I want to give you some insight into how Jefferson went about answering the question of how do you reconcile the sovereignty of the people with limitations on power that secure rights. Here's the paradox. If all power comes from the people, and the only legitimate break on the people's power is the people's power, how do you mobilize that? How do you keep a democratic people through processes of majority rule, the mother principle of republicanism or democracy? How do you keep them from abusing that authority? Because they will do it. Madison famously in Federalist 10 talked about Republican solutions to the problems of Republican government. He was a mechanic devising elaborate machinery to keep Americans from destroying each other, a balance of powers. Jefferson said, you know, what you're really doing, I am again channeling Jefferson, what you're really doing, Jimmy, is you are repackaging the old regime, mixed government. You're just an Anglophile. This is not the solution. This is the problem. This is, we don't have a House of Lords. We come up with some fancy classical way of talking about the Senate. We don't have a king. We have a president. And, of course, a president merely presides. That's the theory. Let's be honest about this new world that we have brought into being. And let's make it thoroughly and comprehensively Democratic or Republican. Here are the two grand solutions that Jefferson, over the course of his later life, after having written the Declaration of Independence and served his country and his state in many capacities, including as President of the United States, retires in 1809 and goes into his most mature period of political thought in which he brings these things together. There are two ways that we can limit the excesses of democracy, democratic ways to secure our rights. The first one I anticipated in talking about his letter to James Madison, "The Earth Belongs to the Living," in 1789. In this letter, Jefferson suggests that the vital principle of democracy is what he described as generational sovereignty, our right to rule ourselves. The idea of aristocracy is based on the supremacy of, many of you are wondering what this hand is doing. I'll put them both in the sky. These are, as I tell my students now, it's very powerful because I've been threatening, I describe myself as a nearly dead white guy in my last days. These are the dead hands of the past. I go, but they still have a chokehold over you forever and ever. Does that make any sense to you? The dead hand of the past. Jefferson particularly worried about this because, of course, he was deep in debt his entire life. Talk about dead hands. We need to do something. No, I'm not going to get sermonic again, but we need to do something about that great debt we have. Jefferson's prophetic, and it was very personal to him. The debts, he died $107,000 in debt, which was an incredible amount of money in those days in 1826. He lived his entire life as if he were, as he put it, a slave to his creditors. That's a very powerful term for a slaveholder to use. We need to overthrow the shackles of aristocracy, of the dead hand of the past, of this emerging commercial money aristocracy. We need to guarantee to each rising generation that it will be able to write the laws under which it lives. That is the vital principle of a successful republic. Now, he wrote this letter to Madison, and Madison couldn't believe that Jefferson would say something so stupid. It was hard work getting that Constitution through at Philadelphia, and even harder work to convince voters in the state ratifying conventions. And you want to go back and do it all over again every 19 years? Now, you might well ask how we get 19 years, and to be more precise, it's 18.8 years. And now you know Jefferson has completely gone bananas. Why would he say 18.8 years? It's because he studied actuarial statistics that were generated in France that suggested, according to the mortality expectations of the French population, that at any given moment, let's say we today all can't even begin to count us all. Let's imagine there are 900 people, not to mention our virtual audience across the street, that we decide to pass a law of some sort, decreeing that Oklahoma Sooners will win every football game in the future. I mean, that's taking popular sovereignty a little too far, I understand. But we pass a law, and be serious about it, and think of some effective way to talk about it. We pass a law in 18.8 years, the then population will include exactly 50% of those people who are alive today, and there will be another 50% who will have come on board. Did they have anything to say about this law? No, they may be Cornhusker fans. I know, this is such a logical absurdity, I'm having Cornhusker fans in Oklahoma. But we're speaking now. This is a teach-in for all mankind, not just for you. So let's just imagine that we have this new generation arrive on the stage. Well, the earth belongs to the living. We need to start all over again. Now, Madison says that is stupid because you know, and of course Jefferson knows, that that generation, my generation, for instance, or us, we don't walk off the stage together. We die one by one. And eventually, if you look at the aggregate, then we have half and half. So how do you operationalize this principle? Good question. But Jefferson is doing a thought experiment here. He's asking us to think, and intuitively you grasp it, because all of us live generationally. That's the cycle of our lives. We have children, we have parents. They have a responsibility to us. We have a responsibility to our children. Here is Jefferson looking forward into the future with a notion of generational stewardship, our generation for the next generation. We have to make sure that they start with a clean slate, that they can devise their own constitution, their own way of living. Think, and this is a figure that Jefferson used himself, imagine that when we were boys and girls, we are suited up in good costumes that are appropriate to our age, but then we grow, and we grow, and we outgrow them. All parents know that you have to get a new wardrobe for the kid every 6 months. Well, imagine that the child has grown to adulthood. Well, you have to have a suit of clothing appropriate to your age. The Constitution as a suit of clothing, that's his metaphor, something we put on. Something we put on to establish our way of being, our way of life, to rule ourselves. That's a little different from the notion of an eternal framework, one that we must fetishize, cherish, and worship. And Jefferson says to you, you should never treat the Constitution, any Constitution, as if it were a sacred thing, the Ark of the Covenant. A constitution is good for what it does and how we can limit ourselves by establishing rules under which we will live as long as we live. But those are not rules forever. Jefferson is famously known to be a strict constructionist. Why is he a strict constructionist? It's precisely because he doesn't worship the Constitution. It's precisely because he wants to hold the authors of that Constitution and the first Federalist administration to their words. You are telling us this Constitution will not destroy our liberties. You are telling us that you are not going to create a consolidated regime like the British imperial monarchical regime. You keep telling us that this is a solution for the problems of the states. Well, we'll see, won't we? Because this is an experiment in republican government, and I am going to hold you to the test. Are you violating the things that you said when you sold it to us? Were you lying? And of course, Hamilton would say, of course we're lying. Any good politician would say that. We needed to get this damn thing through. But Jefferson would say, in all seriousness, there are fundamental principles. There are things that can never be changed without violating the spirit of republicanism. And those have been laid out in the Declaration. That's something that will never change, that notion of consent, that idea of equality. Those are there forever. All the other stuff is like the suit I'm wearing now. We need a new one as we get older. Now, you might say, if you were a cynical 21st century person, Jefferson just doesn't want to give Madison credit, and he wants to change the conversation to say, you know, the really important document was my document, the Declaration. And if this were a two-day conference, and if I were a little more irreverent, I would have worn the Declaration today. But I am instead, and this doesn't do anybody any good who can't really see this, this is the Constitution. And as Akhil Amar is going to tell you, it's a deep and important document. Who wrote the Declaration of Independence? Who wrote the Constitution? Well, we know who wrote the Constitution. That's why we have all this mystifying nonsense about them being founders and framers and larger-than-life individuals. That's all a form of ancestor worship in the making. We're going to worship these guys. That was the problem with the old regime. You were supposed to worship kings. You were supposed to worship the succession of kings across time. All nonsense. Jefferson says, I did not write the Declaration of Independence. The American people did. I was just the vessel, the medium through which the American people articulated these eternal truths, and that's the standard against which we need to measure the Constitution. The question is, we the people, as it says toward the bottom of my tie, who are these people? Are they really speaking? Did Gouverneur Morris ventriloquize the American people? Did they all in one moment speak aloud and say, yes, this will be our law? What were the procedures that get us to the ratification? It's a complicated story. Eventually, Madison, who of course argues against this notion of generational sovereignty, it's not practical, it's not prudent, will, in his emphasis on the state ratifying conventions, say that was where the people came together in their capacity as citizens of their states or representatives of the citizens of their states to speak and to give life to this document. We the people is just a hope when it's written in the Constitution. It becomes real as the people speak. But as I say, the people, do they speak once and then be silent for the rest of time? No. And so Jefferson has these two answers. The first is, as I see it, along a temporal axis through time, that we need a constitutional renewal every generation. I think most civic-minded Americans would agree that the last thing any of us want right now is a constitutional convention. Philadelphia would love it. They need the business. It would be the epitome, the ultimate climax of history tourism if we could have another constitutional convention. That's not going to happen. But the idea, the deep principle that Jefferson's articulating is very important. How do we speak now? And here's his idea. We speak now in the consciousness that we do not speak forever. We are not gods. They were not gods. We'll leave the details to David Boren and how to implement all this. There's a second point, and this is the more radical one on which I will conclude and leaving a few minutes for your comments and questions. The second is to use my notion of space, of time, of segmenting the people. As Jefferson says, every generation is like an independent nation with respect to every other nation. Imagine, international lawyers are going to have to sort this out. Every generation is like a sovereignty. Well, let's take that principle and that spirit and see how you can apply it, how you can make it operational. The second idea is to take not that temporal dimension along what we might describe as a vertical axis, but to flip it to the horizontal, to think spatially. Here is the solution that Jefferson arrived at in his retirement. And that is divide and subdivide. Take the great national republic, break it down to states, to counties, to townships or wards, as he called them. Indeed, if you take this regression from top to bottom, you go all the way to the householder, to Jefferson himself and to his neighbors, who are sovereign over their own domain, over his own plantation or farm. Nobody messes with me on my plantation. That's a basic rule of life and law in the antebellum South. But this principle of division and subdivision, enables us to use the majority rule principle as a check against the excesses of majority rule, because those divisions between the national or federal republic in which we act as if we were one, and when Jefferson is president, he acts for us under the assumption we are one with respect to the rest of the world. And we might have to act with dispatch. We might have to suspend rule of law. We might have to respond to the injunctions of the first law of nature. And folks, that's self-preservation. Number one, the first law of nature. No country, no constitution. Country comes first. But then you move down from the federal level to the state level, and those states have rights that are inviolable. They have rights against each other. States can't encroach on each other. Now, I know all of you serious constitutional scholars and historians will say federalism is very complicated. And yet again, Jefferson is indulging in what we might describe as a thought experiment. But here is what this experiment yields. Because at the federal level, we operate by majority rule, where the delegates of the states, the senators, the representatives coming from districts or from general elections in the states, they operate under the majority rule principle. Same thing applies at the state level. But one thing you can't do at the federal level is to interfere with the states within the proper sphere of their authority. And the same principle goes down all the way to the bottom. In fact, I've described it as moving from top to bottom. What we've really discovered, it's the bottom that's important. That's where the spirit of the Revolution of 1776, of the rights that we hold dear and sacred, those rights are the foundation of this republic. They must be secure. Secure against majorities at a higher level, but they must be governed by the democratic majority rule principle at their own level. Does this begin to make some kind of sense? He's divided the world. It's not going to be checks and balances within the federal government. It's federalism itself that is constitutionalism, and it's only a federal regime that can truly adhere to the foundational principle of democracy, majority rule. We have divided the country into many, many, many jurisdictions, many governments, all of which govern themselves, all of which have inviolable rights with respect to each other, all of which delegate powers upward to achieve common goals, collective security, the national good, whatever that is, the end of global warming. You can fill it in as you will. We delegate upward to achieve common interests. And at every level, we have a selection of individuals who can best represent, articulate, and understand those common interests. And that's a kind of refinement, to borrow the term from James Madison and Gordon Wood, a kind of refinement so that it is a fantasy of a kind of continental meritocracy, where those at the top will have the wisdom to see beyond their own petty interests and to see the collective interest at all. Well, I've gone on for too long, but what I wanted to articulate is this fundamental tension between democracy, between our sense of citizens as having power over how we are governed and ruled, having a say, participatory democracy, and the notion of security in our rights, of predictability, of rule of law. For better or worse, and whether or not he came up with a viable solution, Jefferson recognized a tension which we overlook at our peril, the tension between a government based on our collective will, whatever that is, and a notion that vested rights and interests and property, the modern versions of aristocracy, corporate wealth and power, the new inequality, all of these things are beyond our reach because they're just there. They are our version of the dead hand of the past. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Peter, for such insightful and provocative remarks. And we all enjoyed it very much, and you've left us all thinking. I want to just pause in the middle before I ask for questions from the audience. I notice that our incoming chair and vice chair of the Board of Regents are both here this morning. They've been great supporters of this program, and I'm really glad that both of them are here. Our incoming chair, Dr. Leslie Rainbolt Forbes, and our incoming vice chair, Rick Dunning. Would you both please stand? Thank you very much. We have a microphone down here at the front, and if anyone has a question, I think it would be easiest just to walk down to the microphone, and hopefully as some of you are making your way, and there's some we invite, there are a lot of students I see up in the balcony, you can make your way down and ask a question. While people are coming to the microphone, let me ask you the question. Jefferson, with all of his intense focus on democracy itself, and on the fact that each generation is sovereign as it comes into place. Do you think Jefferson would trust this generation enough, their commitment to particularly not exercising their own rights at the expense of others, those who might be unpopular, for example, to have their right of free speech guaranteed in the Bill of Rights, all of the other things we can think of, would, and you think about the classical education, some were self-educated, but yet they had read broadly of the political philosophers. They had read Locke and they had read others. Compare that to the current American population. How long and how deeply have they felt this? How much have they lifted up unselfishness and what we might call civic virtue? In other words, not the position of don't tax me, tax the other person, don't cut my benefits. Cut someone else's benefits. Are we prepared as a generation to assume the sovereign power that Jefferson talked about to rewrite our Constitution again?
Well, I get to answer that question. That's great. You're taking notes. Take this down. One of the points I wanted to make is that if you have problems with us, they had problems with them. Never forget that. That's the original ism that we should channel. That is the sense of risk and danger and the lack of trust they had in each other. If you think Republicans and Democrats can't get along, well, that's not a question here in Oklahoma because there aren't any more Democrats, but if... Well, people in Jefferson's age had profound reasons not to trust each other and to be afraid that the world would really be turned upside down. And what's remarkable about Jefferson, of course, what the revolution portended for people like Jefferson was servile insurrection and the destruction of the master class. These are real concerns. That is, they're sitting on a time bomb. It's not just that they can't get along with their neighbors. It's much more profound than that. I would say, David, in response to your question, this is for better and worse. We like to tell ourselves that we do well in bad times. When we get nostalgic about the greatest war or the greatest generation or the greatest period in American history, we tend to focus on periods like, say, the 1850s when everything really did fall apart, when the Constitution failed. I like to tell my students, don't get too excited about a constitution which is all about slavery and happily had to be, well, changed, to be honest. We say amended in the Civil War amendments. That was a moment in which we nearly lost control completely. In fact, it's Lincoln's great achievement to establish a connection, a fresh connection with the founding, but particularly with Jefferson's version of the founding, that is with the Declaration, that those principles needed to be defended. Let this experiment not fail. This is the hope for the world, and this is a 19th century in which nations are beginning to declare their right to govern themselves. This is the century of the revolutions of 1848, the failed revolutions of 1848. On behalf of nationhood, let's show that we can overcome our own tremendous problems and keep the thing, keep the spirit alive. So if we're good at making war, and if Lincoln was good at sustaining an idea of something worth preserving at the cost of so many lives, and if we honor that now, and if in doing that he honored Jefferson, then there is a thin, vital connection that links us across the generations. It's war, it's crisis, it's catastrophe. If you're into this kind of thinking, things will have to get a little bit worse before we come to our senses. Is that happening now? Is this the 1850s now? This is not my period. I'm barely alive anymore. I'm not going to... I will say, and I don't mean this to be the usual sort of pious... It's going to sound this way. It's up to us. It really is. It's your sense of what the crisis is. Do you really think that our biggest enemies are the people who disagree with us about entitlements or about what we say about God in public places? Are you kidding me? If that's what gets you excited, then yes, we could be in our own end times. Do we have the vision to see what it is that we confront as a people? Are we a people? Really, the question that goes back to the beginning that I posed, are we a people or not?
Was that inspiration? It absolutely was. Question? You want to ask a question?
Well, since apparently nobody else wants to step up, I'll try to get it rolling. A couple of resounding Jeffersonian ideas you mentioned, state rights and agrarianism, have both suffered from a kind of guilt by association because of subsequent generations. I think association specifically with defense of slavery, secession, and Jim Crow. I'm just wondering if you could reflect on post-Jeffersonian history and suggest that maybe some of these constitutional notions of that Jefferson emphasized and saw as essential to the preservation of a republic, if you could suggest how we might view, you know, localism and popular control in ways that could dissociate those notions from their perhaps unfortunate, but I don't think, you know, necessarily constraining associations. Thank you.
Well, I've been inspirational this morning. That's why I get paid the big bucks, but no, I shouldn't have said that. That was awful. I think we've got that's a wonderful question, and it's a serious problem. I don't know if you can extricate the ideas from their contexts and implications and history, that is, the history of states' rights, or even, and for me more distressingly, the foundational principle of individual rights for Jefferson in his notion of warred republics is the sovereignty of the planter over his plantation. It's the most powerful justification of slavery in the early republic, and that is, it's a question of rights. The property rights, the family rights, domestic, I mean, this is the domestic sphere. These are family values. That is, the householder, the patriarch Jefferson, controlling 200 people as if he were their father. I think that's our challenge, because I do think those ideas speak to something vitally important, and that is the connection, as I tried to put it, between our sense of being children, parents, and ultimately ancestors as we move through the generations. Of can we both think so intimately about our own welfare and that of our children, and think about everybody's welfare? I think Jefferson offers us the opportunity to reflect on these issues. I don't think he has all the answers, but what he certainly does in the Declaration of Independence is to articulate what has now been received as a notion of universal human rights or natural rights. They were bounded for Jefferson himself by the circumstances of his time. All men are created equal does not mean that the captive nation of enslaved Africans have those rights now. One day they would. Jefferson really has a vision of what I would call a Republican millennium or a Democratic millennium. when one day we would reach what Fukuyama called the end of history, when all peoples would be free, including enslaved Africans. But the historic associations of robust democracy at these lower levels of localism and those things that we hate most today is very, very powerful. Can we take the civic energy of participation and engagement and defending our own interests? And Jefferson's all for that, but can that be reconciled with a sense of something beyond ourselves? I think that's, you might say, the great crisis of our times and of all times throughout American history, that tension between the local, the particular, the self-interested, and some kind of broader sense of identification with each other as a people, with the peoples of the world. So that's another glib and unhelpful answer. I'm good at this. I would really like everybody to come to the mic so this could be a true Jeffersonian revival. If that's going to happen, however, nobody else gets to speak today, and or every question has to be answerable by yes or no.
I apologize because we do have to start the next program in about 5 minutes, so to stay on schedule today. But such an intellectual feast, the courses will be served very quickly. This will have to be our last question. I'm sorry. Maybe you can save the next questions for our speaker about George Washington. And there's certainly some conflicting ideas between the two of them. Yes, go ahead.
If you were channeling Jefferson, how would you advise the people who are occupying Wall Street?
Well, I know Jefferson. He lives in Williamsburg. We call him Bill Barker, but he's a Jefferson impersonator. And I'll send Bill up to Wall Street. I don't know. The thing is, Jefferson hates banks. You got to understand that about Jefferson. He hates the kind of mysterious control that's exercised over our lives and deprives us of our liberties. Now, it's not just a simple knee-jerk populist reaction to the masters of the universe, though it has some flavor of that as well. I think he would say that the energy, the kind of participation, and he would say this to tea parties as well, that this is a civic resource, but can it be more than it is now? The criticism of the Wall Street people is they don't have a program. It's not their fault. I mean, this is an existential crisis for our unemployable college graduates. There are students here, I should be careful. talk about the living generation. I don't know, is this generation going to get a chance? I think this is something, I get to articulate my own opinions here when I'm pretending to talk about Jefferson. I think Jefferson would have been appalled at the inequality that characterizes the United States of America today, and that we can try to conjure it away by talking about how competition in markets is going to produce virtuous outcomes, and we all benefit from a growing economy. But there are elements, and I think this is what Jefferson would be sensitized to today. He was always on the lookout for recrudescent aristocracy. Sorry about that fancy, stupid word. But there are aristocrats in our midst. And they will use any power they can to become rent seekers. Take your pick, to live off the bounty of the work and the productive labor of others. I have to say, given Jefferson's commitment to a substantive notion of equality, which included violations of property rights, Jefferson didn't think property was sacred, because that's exactly the principle of the old regime, is that what is must be. I think Jefferson would be in deep sympathy, but he'd also be in deep sympathy with populists on the right, that sense of dissatisfaction that we're not talking about the things that matter to us. However we might question the motives and the programs of those people who are out in the streets now making life ugly and difficult, they are expressing something important, and I think Jefferson would say, as he said about Shays' rebellion, a little rebellion now and then can be a good thing. It's like a storm in the atmosphere. We have storms in our atmosphere. We cut the weather channel so we can track them at all times. And I think we need to have a kind of political weather channel that's going to produce some higher wisdom beyond the schadenfreude of watching people suffer from drought and... Oh, God, get me off the stage.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I know that when Peter said a little rebellion now and then is not a bad thing, he was not speaking about universities as an institution, as a place where this should take place. I want to emphasize that in case any students might misunderstand what Peter was just saying. Well, we thank him very, very much for his remarks. Let's thank him again as he takes his seat.